Happy New Year! Man, if I'd known I'd lived this long, I'd take better care of myself. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I wouldn't be fat like I am right now. If I could take care of myself, I'd have got on that treadmill sooner. Got on that bicycle before somebody stole it out of my front door. Man, it made me mad. I spent good money on a good bike. Someone stole it off my front porch. Sorry. Okay, I hope the chain broke and they got hurt. All right. Amen. Praise the Lord in the name of the Lord. With all the love I know how. Amen. With all the love I know how. I'm so glad you guys are here. We're going to take a mission offering this morning. It is the first Sunday of the month. How many remembered that? I didn't until earlier. And so I thought, man, it is the first Sunday of the month. And our missions offering last year, Brother Kevin, help me out, where's Brother Kevin? He's in Oxford. We gave out over $10,000 in missions last year. Then over $10,000 out of this little old church in Seminole, Oklahoma. Praise his name. We're just trying to struggle by. And he gave us we gave out over $10,000 in missions offering, and we brought in, you ready? How much we brought in? $9,800 and something. It's not as bad as I thought. I was impressed. Okay, so we're going to give up this morning. We're going to give to the Lord. And how many of you guys want to go I don't want to say England because y'all will go. I'm going to be a missionary to Ireland. You know? Now, how many want to go to someplace nobody wants to go? I don't want to go. But I'll sure give my offering that somebody else can be blessed. Amen? And so we're going to give this morning to our missions offering. How many know we have 5 missionaries we give to? Okay. And if you don't know who they are, right behind Donald is a list of missionaries. And then you can find ours. And I don't want to run through them right now, but you can get it. Okay, we're going to pray over the offering that God bless not only this offering, but also bless our missionaries. Keep them safe. Amen. It's an amazing thing to take a family and just go to another country. And that's just nuts to me. Now, they can, the Lord love them. Amen. When everybody in Seminole gets saved, I'll go somewhere else. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's just pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you bless this offering this morning. As our church gives into this offering, I pray blessing upon not only us for giving, but also for the receiver of that, that they'll have protection, that they'll have anointing, they'll have your favor in their country that they're in this morning, God. I ask that you touch them, ask that you bless them and their families. And Father, we give you praise in Jesus' name. Everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. I'm so glad that you guys are here this morning in the house of the Lord. I apologize about Children's Church, but Heike, I didn't find out until like 10 minutes until church time. She just said, I'm so sorry. She apologized like 5 times. She said, I just can't. And so she's pretty sick, or she'd be here. And so remember her. I know Matthew was very ill this morning. Becky called in sick for him this morning. And so she called and said, Matthew's sick. And so I said, all right, so I appreciate that. But there's a lot of people that are sick this morning, a lot of, I guess, flu or whatever's going around. And as long as it goes around me, we're good. But I don't want it. And so just remember those people in prayer this morning. And I thank you so much for getting out in the elements this morning. Is it a whole 50 degrees or something like that? I'm about to take my shirt off. I'm burning up. Y'all don't want that. But it's all good. If I could get away with it, you know, one day I'm going to just wear shorts and stand behind the pulpit. I'm shorts and bands on. Y'all won't know. I'll put a jacket on. Y'all won't know. Amen. And so, until I walk off. I had shorts on. Okay. And so, But I'm going to tell you how much I appreciate this church, how much you guys have been a blessing. Last year was a great year for us. We did a lot of stuff. But this year is a year of transformation for us. Now, God's given me a word for this year, and it's transformation for the church. And I talked to our staff yesterday, the leadership staff, as far as the ministry leader staff. We had a conversation with them last night, or yesterday morning, I guess it was. And engage is what we're going to do in that. But for the church, it's transformation. Transformed. Be what God's called us to be. Amen?
Amen.
Be what the church that God's called us to be. And, you know, I've been the pastor here for 5 years, so it's time for me to just be who I want to be. And and not quit trying to be somebody else and just be who I am. Amen. And you know, if you love me, you love me. If you don't, that's all right. I love you anyway. It's okay. It's all gonna be good. But we're gonna talk about being transformed today for just a minute. You know, if you don't love me, I bet we make it anyway. What do you bet? I bet my wife's still gonna love me whether you love me or not. She's thinking about it. My kids are gonna. I'm still gonna be their dad. You know, whether they love me or not, it's always up in the air. But I'm still gonna be their dad, and we're still gonna get. My life's gonna be the same. I love you, and I want you to know that. The transformation's got to take place. We got to transform who we are. Transformation is this: to change or alter completely in nature, form, or function. And what I mean by that is this: to transform something by nature, form, and function is this: is that we do a lot of good stuff. We do. There's a lot of good stuff about coming to church here. There's a lot of good things, a lot of good people in here. And see, I'd already blown it. I'd already marked out and went down. I'd have my shorts on, and y'all wouldn't listen to me because I walked out in front. You didn't know that I had my shorts and Vans on. So anyway, listen. But we do a lot of cool stuff here. We do a lot of good things here. But what I mean by transformed is this: not to throw the baby out with the bathwater, but to change the bathwater. Can somebody just help me just a minute? That baby's been getting washed in the same water for a while. It's time to transform some things and change the bathwater and make that. How many love it when your babies get out of the bath and how they smell? And you have to get them all lotioned up, man. And they're all greased up. Well, we put lotion on our babies. I don't know what y'all did. But our babies, they had lotion, I mean, from head to toe, man. They had Johnson, that pink, whatever. And this, whatever it is. And then, I mean, between their toes and squishy between. Y'all didn't do that?
Yeah.
Isn't that, cause that's probably the coolest thing, you know. And so you slick them all down, you put that diaper on them, and they just smell so good, right? Yeah, it's time to get some babies clean. Lotion them all up. Get that Johnson's and Johnson's out. Just squirt it. You know, squirt it down. Get them ready. Get them all cleaned up and to where they smell like a baby, you know. And, I don't remember what, I don't know if they ever used Pampers. I think it was Pampers we used, wasn't it? And you just, man, they had that baby smell on them, you know. They smell new. Clean. For about 5 minutes. Then you hear that noise, you go, man, really? And then you gotta get the wipes out. We're trying to clean up our babies, and we have some things that we need to transform, which is the water. We need to transform some of the water. I didn't give my babies the same bath and the same water because that water was funky. Okay, so you drain it, you clean out the bathtub or the sink. How many ever use the kitchen sink? Oh, yeah. I said, y'all from Oklahoma. So we use the kitchen sink and you spray them down. And you know, it's all awesome, okay? And so, but we use the kitchen sink and we clean them up, but we didn't leave the water there and we didn't wash our dishes in the same sink. That's just nasty. And so we clean the water, we drain the water, we clean out the sink. Because why? Because it has to be changed and something has to be different. It has to be transformed. That water that was in there is now polluted and needs to be transformed. And so we have to come up with another way. And listen, I don't wash my dishes in the same temperature of water that I wash my baby in. Right? Maybe y'all do. I don't know. But I didn't do that. Okay? Maybe your baby's really dirty. You got to get that hot water going. So, but you change the water temperature. You change the soap that you use. I didn't wash my babies with Dawn. Okay? They didn't get washed with Dawn. But they got washed with what was appropriate for the time. Amen? And so, just if you haven't noticed, I love being a dad. I thought it was the coolest thing ever. If we'd have gotten married before, if they had come to our senses earlier, we would have had more children. Honey. You hated me 6 months before we got married, so I don't hear it. Okay, so here. It's the truth. Ask anybody that was here. Okay? She couldn't stand me 6 months before we got married. So here's the deal. True story. Thank you, Lisa, for it. Okay. And so, man, she finally chased me down. I may have embellished that. Okay, here's the deal. But this is a year of transformation for this church. This is a year that we're going to do things a little differently than we've ever done before. I didn't say we're throwing out the baby with the bathwater, but we are going to change the bathwater. It's time for transformation. On this first day of the year, 1997. First day of the year, 2017. Yahoo. Okay? We're going to do things a little differently than we've ever done. He said, oh, I've heard that before, Brother Jeff. No, I mean it. God has been dealing with me since October about doing some things that are different and transforming some things and changing some of the areas of our church. And since October, God began to deal with me on some issues, and I'm going to have to meet with some people individually about it. It's not from the pulpit kind of conversation to have, but to transform means to change, to alter, to completely modify and form and function. That doesn't mean we're going to throw everybody away. It means that we're going to change the way we do things. I look around you this morning, and the church is kind of full, but it's not completely full. Last January, the first service of January, there was 147 people in service that day. 147 that morning. And today we're 30 short of that. Now I know there's a lot of people sick this morning. I know there's a lot of people that aren't able to be here this morning. Tommy and Jan are gone to Alaska. Matthew's sick. Buddy and Kay aren't here because Buddy's not feeling well. There's several that are out. Kaika's not here because she's not feeling well. And so there's a lot of things that are going on this morning that maybe weren't going on last year. I know that. But understand me for just a minute. Some things we have to look at those and say, somehow, I don't want to just maintain. I want to accelerate where we're going. I know that we are limited in space. Because I don't know if you know this, but you know, I have a lot of room up here. Okay. But a lot of folks don't have a lot of room where they're sitting. Because there's no elbow room. Schoolhouse Rock? Elbow room. Nobody watched Schoolhouse Rock? Okay, yes sir. Okay. I know in 1997 we watched Schoolhouse Rock. But I'll talk to you about transformation, not because the calendar date changed. That has nothing to do with it. But because, not because our calendars changed, but because we've changed. We've gone from 2011 in August 2011 when I got more yeses than noes to be the pastor, and I just kind of let everything just kind of do what it's always done, and at that time we had about 40 people or something like that coming to church on a regular basis, this wasn't even thought of at that time. There was just a bunch of people that weren't here, and so. When that happened in August of 2011, it just kind of let everything kind of just ride because we didn't really have to do anything. It was different because we just had our 45 people and we were just hanging out and doing our thing. But as we begin to grow, I've changed. Who I am has changed. The call of God has not changed on my life. I still want to do what I... When I first stepped in this pulpit, the first thing I began to do was preach about Nehemiah, about rebuilding the walls, and talked about how the foundation is solid. We just need to rebuild the walls of what God has already given us. And God has given us a great foundation to build on, but at some point we got to build the wall, amen? At some point we got to build the sheep gate. At some point we got to build the dung gate, the fish gate. At some point it's all got to be built. The walls have got to be put, the gates have got to be put up, and somebody's got to be the person on the wall that has a sword in one hand and trowel in the other, and is building the wall and ready to fight if the enemy comes against us. Yeah. And so we're not transforming just because the calendar has changed, but because I've changed and we've changed. The new year is simply a great starting point. It's a great place because we're all, how many say, man, I know next year's going to be worse than this one. No, we don't go into the next year going, oh, it's going to be awful. But if you do, we'll pray for you because I want you to be optimistic, not pessimistic. And so I want you to go, yeah, we're going to have better than we've ever had. Everybody goes into the next year believing the next year is going to be better just because the calendar changed. And so next year is a fresh start, amen? It's a fresh start. So we talked to you this morning about transformation and Jesus transforming everybody he touched. And I've got 25 minutes, so you have to listen fast. Okay? You with me? When Jesus is the focus, transformation happens quickly. So in this church, Jesus is going to become the focus. You're going to hear this a lot. Our leadership's going to be engaged in your life. They've got to be engaged in your life. Okay. Our leadership is going to engage in you. Not just with the same people they've always engaged with. We had a meeting yesterday morning. That was one of the focal points of the meeting. It's not just to engage in our own family. Not to be introverted, but to be extroverted. Not just to come together and as be, well, you know, for me it's easy because I think most people in here are kin to me somehow. Most people in Seminole are probably kin to me somehow. I don't know. But, you know, most people in here are kin somehow through marriage or through whatever. Most of my blood relatives are gone, so it's normally just through marriage that I'm kin to most folks. But just because I'm kin to you, it's easy to go to them. It's easy to go to talk to them. It's easy to be in a social event with them because I know them. But our leadership, including me, have got to start being extroverted and start being people that reach out to those who don't know who we are. It's easy for me to walk up and talk to anybody in here. But it's not so easy if you're a visitor or if you don't really know anybody, if you just came with somebody for a few times and everybody seems to know each other and you're just sitting there going, yeah, this is fun. Well, we're having fun now. And so I don't want it to be that way. I want us to engage in your lives. So the new year is simply a great place to start when Jesus is the focus. I want Jesus to be the focus. In Luke chapter 1, verse 28 through 31, that's where we're going to start. Luke chapter 1, verse 28 through 31. An angel came in to her and said, "Hail, thou art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women." And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God." Last one. "And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus." Go back to 28, if you will, for me, please. Listen to me. When Jesus had not even been on this planet yet, he had already transformed a young girl's life. He had just been spoken of by an angel to a young lady. First of all, for an angel to show up and speak to you transforms your life. Secondly, when the angel says, "I know you're not married, I know you don't have a husband, I know you don't have anything like that, but you're going to become impregnated with the Holy Spirit, and you're going to bring forth a son, you're going to call his name Jesus," because why? Because you have found favor with God. And so when that happens, that automatically changes her life again. So the first thing that happens, she was minding her business, doing her thing. She wasn't praying to be the mother of the Messiah. She wasn't praying to be Christ's mother. She was just doing her thing. She's planning a wedding. She's a spouse of Joseph. She's got stuff to do. She's hemming garments. She's putting veils and stuff on. Because she's playing the band. Because she's getting it all together, right? She's minding her own business. And God interrupts her life. And an angel shows up and says, "Hail, Mary." And she threw a football. She said, "Hail, thou art highly favored." Y'all get it. "The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women." Now, wait a minute. I wasn't blessed. I got Joseph. He's got a good job. He's a carpenter. He's going to marry me. He's going to kiss me on the mouth. He's going to marry me. Okay? And so he's there and it's a song. It's Dolly Parton song. Nobody ever heard that song? Okay. And so he's there and he says, "Hail, thou art blessed among women." Go to verse 29. "And when she saw him, she was troubled." Her life had just now been turned upside down. Well, come on, y'all. Y'all got to get rid of me. "And cast her mind on what manner of salutation this should be," or "What is this fool saying?" Come on. That is a beautiful way of saying, "What are you talking about? You were crazy. When she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, because she said, you're crazy. I'm not, you know, who are you? And anyway, go to verse 30. And the angel said unto her, what? What does the angel always say? Fear not. Because I'm thinking, if an angel shows up, I'm being fearful. One of two things is happening. I'm dying, right? Or God's going to ask me to do something I don't want to do. Right? Fear not. Either I'm dying, or God's fixing to ask me to do something. So when an angel shows up, there's two outcomes. Okay? And so the angel said unto her, fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. Verse 31. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, thou shalt call his name Jesus. You can read the rest of it later. But hear me just a second. Here's the deal. She's minding her business, and an angel shows up and transforms her life at the very mention of Jesus' name. There was no Jesus in her womb yet. There was no Jesus born yet. There was no Jesus on this planet yet. But at the very mention of her name, of his name, her life was transformed and changed. Because when Jesus is the focus in your life is automatically transformed and changed. Just by the spoken name of Jesus, your life can be changed. By someone speaking Jesus into your life. Amen. By somebody speaking Jesus from this pulpit. By somebody speaking Jesus at you at an altar. And when somebody just speaks Jesus into your life is transformed and changed. You'll never be the same. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you say. You're Mr. Tough Guy or Miss Tough Guy. Whatever. Okay? Jesus will treat you like Nunez took care of Ronda Rousey. She will transform your face. Some of y'all don't have a clue who that is. He will transform you. That nose that was breathing well will have blood coming from it. Amen. Because God will mess you up if you ever have an encounter with God. If you actually have an encounter with God, and not just say, well, I know Jesus and I said a prayer. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about an encounter with God. I'm talking about when somebody shows up, speaks into your life, and your life is transformed and turned upside down, and something is different in your life. When your life is transformed by the very spoken name of Jesus, not in Jesus inside of you, not Jesus anywhere, but just spoken into your life. Just spoken. Mary's life was changed forever before the conception. We can talk about the Immaculate Conception or Reception, however you want to call it. Depends if you're a football fan. And it's a conception, the Immaculate Conception. You can talk about that all you want to. But before he was ever conceived in her womb, he changed her life. So before, listen, when you walked in this building right now, when you stepped in you stepped into the front door here, when we begin to speak Jesus into your life will never be the same. Your spirit will never be the same. Why? Because your spirit leaps inside of you when Jesus' name is named out into your life. At the mention of Jesus, her life was changed forever from Joseph's fiance to the mother of Christ in an instant. In an instant. From the first time his name was spoken, you shall call his name Jesus. From the very first time his name was spoken out loud, her life was changed, transformed. From making plans to a wedding to making plans for a baby. And I don't know if you know this or not, there's a little different preparation for a wedding to a baby. Things change. Everything in her life changed in a moment because of Jesus. How many know who John the Baptist is? It's not a guy named John that goes up the hill. That's not John the Baptist. John the Baptist is Jesus' cousin, 6 months his elder. John the Baptist. You know the story, right? His dad is a priest in the temple. And he wasn't going to name him John. And God said, yeah, you are. Or you're not going to talk for the rest of your life. Oh, God wouldn't do that. Yeah. You're either going to name the boy John, or you're going to be a mute for the rest of your life, whichever you want. But John the Baptist, Mary came to visit Elizabeth, her cousin. And she told Elizabeth what the angel had said. And not only was Elizabeth filled with the Holy Ghost at the very instant, but the baby leaped inside the womb of Elizabeth, and also, I believe, was filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That the very mention of Jesus' name from a human being, the very mention of the name Jesus transformed Elizabeth and John. Changed their lives forever. John the Baptist became John the Baptist. Before, he was John Elizabeth's boy. Now he's John the Baptist because he began to baptize people in the River Jordan, and he began to change the mind and the thinking and said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And so, remember the story. So John the Baptist leaped in his mother's womb at the very news of Jesus. The spirit, I believe the spirit of Elijah, the forerunner of Christ, fell on John before his birth. Come on. That Spirit of God fell on John. And so, you know, whenever, and you guys can get mad at me if you want to, but when people say that's not a human being inside the womb of a woman and it's just a lump of flesh, you're a liar, liar, pants on fire, and the devil's a liar. If God can, listen, if God can transform a young man at 6 months old in the womb, if God says, I knew you before I ever formed you in the belly, if God says that you are wonderfully fearfully and wonderfully made, if He can do that and place you in your mother's womb, I'm just here to tell you, as soon as God places you in that womb, God has a plan and a mission for your life. I don't care what slick hair, shiny shoe preacher need to sell a book told you, that it is not okay to suck that baby out and kill that baby. It's not okay. And they can get mad at me, and it's on video. How y'all doing? Okay, here we go. Listen. John leaped in his mother's womb. The spirit fell on him. Christ fell on John the Baptist before he was ever born on this planet. Before he ever fell on this planet, before he ever came out of the womb of his mother, he transformed his mother's life. He transformed Joseph's life, because Joseph was now like, now what am I going to do? He transformed Elizabeth's life, transformed his cousin John's life. And he wasn't even born yet. He hadn't even breathed the first breath of oxygen on this planet yet. The disciples, I'll speed ahead. The disciples, Peter, James, and John, were fishing. They were working. And Jesus said, come follow me. Matthew was collecting taxes. He had his good IRS job going on. He was collecting taxes. Jesus said, follow me. Luke was a physician. He was taking care of sick folks. Judas was hanging out with him. He was a sojourner to the land. And Jesus was hanging out. He was the keeper of the money. He was the treasurer. But Peter, James, and John were fishing. And Jesus said, come follow me. And he transformed their life. Can you imagine here? Listen to me now for just a second. Within 3.5 years, Jesus had taken fishermen who knew nothing about anything else that he was talking about, but they knew about fishing and knew about all these things. And Jesus said, I'll make you fishers of men if you follow me. And within 3.5 years, they went from talking to fish to talking to kings. Can somebody help me just a minute? Can you understand what I'm telling you? That Peter, James, and John were in a sailboat, true, but they were the sons of thunder, right? And so they were there when Jesus was transfigured. They were there in the house when the damsel was sick and was died and it came back to life. They were there with Jesus. They were his inner circle of men. They went from fishermen to fishers of men. They were Jesus's right hand guys. John became the one that Jesus loved the most, the beloved, John the beloved. John was the one that was exiled to the Isle of Patmos, wrote the book of Revelation. It was John. It was John. Come on now. Come on, somebody help me just a minute. Jesus turned their lives upside down. Because when Jesus is the focal point, you will never be the same as you are today. If Jesus is the focal point of a church, the church will never be the same. If the people are the focal point, we'll always stay the same. You just have to forgive me a minute. But God's been dealing with me for a long time, and I've got to preach this yet, and I'm just trying to throw it out there. When you want to be the star, when the congregation wants to be the star, the church never changes because you can't transform my life. But when we want to follow the star, when we want to be like the wise men, and we want to be like the shepherds and follow the star, when we want to get to where he is at, and not simply want him to be where I'm at. Come on, somebody. But I want to get where he's at, and I want to follow after him. I want to be with him. I don't expect him to come find me. You ever think about this? The manger didn't float to the shepherds. The shepherds went to the manger. The manger didn't go to the wise men. The wise men came to the manger. Come on, somebody. We got to follow after Jesus. He's got to be our focal point. He's got to be our number one. He's got to be it. Listen, I don't know if I'm talking to anybody this morning or not, but y'all sitting there looking at me like I'm crazy. But can I just tell you for a minute? Y'all looking at me like bumps of logs. But I want you to understand for just a minute. I want you to get this in your spirit. Peter, James, and John were fishing, and Jesus changed their lives. Luke was a physician, and he changed their life. Matthew was a collector of taxes, but he changed his life. Judas was trying to follow Jesus, but he just couldn't do it. And he turned and kissed Jesus and hung himself and died. Paul, how many know who Paul is? He was Saul for a little time. And he went from holding coats as they were stoning Stephen to being the enforcer of the Jewish synagogue and bringing those sorry Christians to justice. Yeah. It was Paul who wrote most of the New Testament. Most of it he wrote from prison. You don't do that for somebody that's just, James, Jesus' brother James, they threw him off the temple and beat him to death with sticks. You don't do that unless you know your brother, your half-brother, is who he says he is. You wouldn't do that just to save the family name. They'd whack you a couple times. Okay, he's lying. Okay, he's lying. He's not who he said he was. But James took a beating. James got his skull crushed in, and they beat him to death. But why? Because of the truth of his half-brother Jesus was the Messiah. So Paul was holding coats, and he was at the stoning of Stephen. He became the enforcer of the Jewish synagogue because he was taking Christians and having them executed. But God transformed his life, and from Saul he became Paul, because Jesus met him on a Damascus road somewhere and got into his spirit, because when Jesus shows up, transformation takes place. When Jesus is the focal point, transformation takes place. When you know that you've heard from God, transformation takes place. Every life was transformed by the thought of Jesus.
Amen.
Just the thought that you can become pregnant with the Christ, the Christ child, the Messiah. Just the thought, Mary, transformed her thinking and her life. Just the thought. An angel coming and saying, this is what's going to happen. Okay? The birth of Jesus transformed Mary's life, Joseph's life, the shepherd's life, the wise man's life. It transformed the world.
Amen.
By the birth of Jesus. He hadn't even learned to talk yet. He was just in the manger laying there. And he'd already affected the world. So how is it that we can sit around and say, I'm a follower of Christ, and never be affected by what Christ did? How can we say that God has transformed me and nothing in our life ever changed? How can we say that Christ is the focal point of a church that never changes? How can we say that Christ is the focal point of our lives, but our lives are always the same? They're always in chaos. They're always upside down. They're always, will the devil find me? No, maybe Jesus just isn't the focal point of your life.
Amen.
And you get what you get because of what you do.
Yes.
Come on, somebody, help me a minute. Maybe you get the The fruits of your labor. Can I say that? Can I say it that way? Instead of following after Christ, you follow after your own desires and your own will and your own things, and you never really get transformed because it's easier to follow after what I want to do instead of what God wants me to do, because after all, you know, God wants me happy. God wants me happy. Of course He wants you to be happy. But listen, He wants you to be holy more than He wants you to be happy. Okay. Lesson 101. Holy doesn't mean hallelujah. Blessed thou. White shirt, black pants, white socks, black shoes. That's not holy, okay? That's not what we're looking at. We're looking for people who are sold out to Jesus. Jesus, what do you want me to do? I'll do it. I'll work. I'll work and do whatever it is that you want me to do. Okay. He transformed everything. I've got 6 minutes. Can I have 7? I'm going to take it anyway. It doesn't matter. I'm tired of our people fading out and nobody knows what happens to them. Because we're not engaged in their lives. As the pastor of this church, what kind of pastor would I be if I just let people go because they didn't matter? Because who they are, their last name, their first name, who they're connected to. Well, they reap what they sow, brother. They reap what they sow. And this said, they reap. No, this don't know what I said. I'm not about babying people. I fear you got to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, like the word God said. You've got to suck it up and you've got to do it yourself. I can't keep you saved. I can't pray you saved. I can't do anything to keep you like you need to be. But I can't encourage you. I can't hold you by the hand and encourage you and pull you up out of the mess.
Amen.
I can maybe have a kind word for you when you haven't heard one in a while. I can be that person that calls and checks on you. And listen, we've been horrible about that, and I apologize to you. That we will be better. I promise you, we will be better at making sure that you're okay. But there's times that people fade in and fade out, and nobody knows what happened to them. They were part of this group or that group, they're part of the volunteer staff, and all of a sudden they're just gone. Nobody knows why. They don't have any idea where they've been. It's been a month and a half since they've been to church. No one's ever even said anything to them.
Yeah.
You know what's the truth?
Yeah.
So that's got to stop. Because how can we say we're disciples of Christ and not take care of people? We can't do it. Well, y'all quiet on me. Y'all been quiet on me the last 3 times I've preached, and I don't know if I'm doing bad or doing good. No, I don't have any idea. I don't have any idea. It doesn't matter. So, with my last 4 minutes, just share this with you. Jesus changed these people's lives in this manner. Mary submitted. John leaped. Disciples followed. The shepherds prayed. Stephen prayed. Judas kissed and died. The Pharisees hated him. The Sadducees sought to kill him. The Romans beat and killed his body. The earth opened up and received him. The grave couldn't hold him. Time was split in two. Everything in this planet was transformed by Jesus. So let me ask you a question, Mr. and Mrs. Christian. Have you been transformed? I'm not saying you haven't been, I'm asking. Is there anything different in your life today than it was before you said yes to Jesus? There better be a change. If there's not a change, you got the wrong Jesus. You got Jesus. Oh, you don't get Jesus. Okay? You better get hold of the right thing. Because I'm just letting you understand, I want you to understand something. You cannot be touched by Jesus and not be transformed.
That's right.
No way, no how, no, you can't do it. You simply cannot not be transformed and touched by Jesus. Everything on this planet was transformed by Jesus. Aren't you ready to be changed? Aren't you ready?
Amen.
Come on now. Y'all help me a minute. Aren't y'all ready just for God to change this thing in our lives? Aren't you ready going through the same cycle, the same? Aren't you tired of that yet? Aren't you tired of the same problems you've had for the last 30 years? Aren't you tired of not having enough money? Aren't you tired of not having enough peace in your life? Aren't you tired of not having enough of your children that are living for God? Aren't you tired of that mess? Aren't you ready for God to transform something in your life? Yes. To where your children come home? Yes. Not to your house, but to God. Yes. You may not want them back at your house, but you want to come. You want to come home to God. They can go live somewhere else. Nice to visit. Okay, we'll see. Alright. And so, but aren't you ready for them to come home to the Lord? Aren't you ready for them to be delivered? Aren't you tired of shouting about somebody else's miracle when you've been believing one for one for a long time? And it's not that I begrudge them their miracle, their answer. But what about me, Lord? If you're no respecter of person, what about me? What about my children? What about my family? What about them? What about my cousins? What about them? God, I want you to come quickly, Lord, but I don't want you to come right now because I got family that's crazy. Come on, somebody help me just a minute. Come on now. This year is a year of transformation for our church. It's a time of transformation for your life. We will be transformed this year. God's going to change the way we do things this year. God's going to transform us. Well, and I can see right now you're excited about it. And so I want you to understand that God is going to do some greater things in this place than he ever has done before. And I know you're sitting there saying, yeah, we've heard it before, Brother Jeff. I want to see something happen. Well, you just hide and watch, honey, because God's going to change some things in your life. And whether you want to change or not, God's going to hit you with something, and something's going to change in your life. You better not keep hanging around here. If you don't want anything in your life to change, don't keep hanging around here. Because I refuse to be this year like I was last year. I'm not going to have the same stinking problems. I'm not going to have the same blessings this year as I had last year. We're going to have greater and greater and greater. Listen, the Bible says this. I didn't say it this way, but I'm going to give you a Jeff Nance translation. Come as you are. Come to the Lord. Come however you need to come to the Lord, come. Don't clean yourself up. Don't get yourself all prettied up. There's a song by Crowder that says, come as you are. Come as you are. Come, sinner. Come. Let the healing begin in your life. Come, let God begin to deal with your life. Let that baby leave in your womb. Let your life be transformed. Let something change in your life. Be that person that God called you to be. Don't simply just be a pew sitter. Pew sitting is fine for some people, but there's some of you that are sitting on pews. You have no business sitting on a pew because God's placed more in you than that. God's placed more in you. He's placed a calling in your life. There are volunteer places in this church to work. You need to work. You need to be part. And we're going to do a better part of begging you, yelling at you, griping at you, to get you to be part. Amen? We're going to bug you. We're going to be that church that's annoying. I just missed one Wednesday. We should have missed. Okay? So, we want to miss. Listen, our group leaders, we talked about it yesterday. Don't get mad at them when they begin to call you and begin to bug you and harass you. Because we want you to be part of what God's doing. We want you to be blessed today. I want you to be, I just, listen, you may not agree and you may disagree with me, but I got a captive audience of the Temple of Praisers here, okay? I think we got something good going on, man. We're missing some folks this morning. You know there's some people sitting home right now that don't feel like they matter. It doesn't matter if I go to church or not. No one cares. I'm just telling you. I mean, I've been doing this a long time. There's some people sitting at home right now that don't think that you care a plug nickel about. And they get offended when they walk in and say, oh, we've been missing you, but they hadn't heard from you in 4 weeks. Thank you, Jesus. We love the white boy preacher. Hallelujah. They heard from you in 4 weeks, but it's an easy thing to say, hey, we've been missing you, when they walk in, because we're listening. If we truly miss them. If we truly miss them, then we miss them. Listen, I'm not getting on to you about, I'm the world's worst, and I forget about who's here and who's not here. And I look out today, and I'll try to remember who wasn't here today. And I'll remember Matthew wasn't here. And I'll remember Buddy and Kay weren't here. You with me? Look at me. Look at me. That's my family. So I'll remember them. Do we remember that Robin and Charity aren't here this morning? We remember that Zane's not here this morning? We remember that Les Cogburn's not here this morning? Come on now. Come on, don't get upset with me. I'm just telling you the truth. Riker, I'm sorry. But I love you this morning. Love you. I appreciate you very much. And I just wanted to share with you some of my heart for this next coming year. For our leadership is engaged. For our church's transformation. Our leaders are going to be engaged more than they ever have before. And if they're not, let me know. Because I need to know. That's not something I'm going to be mad at them. It's just something we need to pray. Transformation for the church means changes are afoot. Things are in the works. Send your feet.